very, very much appreciate you being here. And also, I've been working on this topic for about 7 years, so I appreciate you sticking with me. I'm trying to write a book about it, and it's not out yet. People say, just publish the book already. But it's actually a hard enough topic. Unlike my first book, which I feel like I was able to write in 6 months, this one has taken me quite a number of years to understand the problem and describe it. So I've given this talk a lot in different formats, and I feel like this is the best one yet, or at least I hope that's the case. If you've seen the abstract, it's basically like, look, we've seen this shift in security, and I've been tracking it for many, many years, having worked over 25 years in security, and I see more and more crisis-like events. So I'm trying to educate people about how to avoid those events. If you have any kind of machine learning in any environment, I really encourage you to look deeply into who's been developing it and how so that you don't run into a breach, if you will. And breaches are harder to define in integrity than they were in availability, which is downtime, or confidentiality, which is exposure, loss of confidentiality. Fairly easy to describe. Integrity has become a whole different discipline. It's almost like magic. You know, you talk about, do I have an availability breach? Well, it's kind of easy at some point to figure out how denial of service attacks work. But when you talk about, you know, do you know how to do an integrity breach? You're doing some pretty funky stuff. In CFO terms, you might say Enron was an integrity breach and Kenneth Lay got, you know, put in jail for it. Kurt Skilling, these guys got held accountable. But in finance, it's a little easier to say there's an integrity issue around counting numbers. But when you get around to convincing people to do the wrong thing, much, much harder. Let 'em Have It is one of the classic cases in British history where somebody who was presumed to be mentally disabled was told to let him have it when he had a gun, and the police shot him because they thought he was saying, shoot them. So there's a lot of examples in history and literature around, you know, integrity being very hard to define when you get out of the bean counting exercises. So they always tell me to keep a personal story in the talks here. I've been talking for 10 years at RSA every year, and so here's my personal story. A long time ago, I was flying into a small ocean island, and I landed on this island to just sort of have fun and sort of hang out, and it turns out that I was having such fun that I got invited by some locals. I actually ended up playing spoons because the spoon player fell drunk and couldn't play anymore. It's not hard to play spoons, but he was that drunk. And so they said, hey, you're pretty good at the spoons. Why don't you come down and hang out with some of our friends? Now, this is after midnight. There's a big moon. We're literally drinking coconuts. We're in this sort of hut. And it's in French. And they start talking about how they're going to overthrow the government. And they're like, what do you think? And I realize I have this outsized influential role, just given the population size, into the future of this country because I could play spoons and I didn't get too drunk. So the authorization model for the entire future of this country was at stake. Well, this isn't far from my actual research. My background actually is in interventions, humanitarian interventions and coups. And so one of the things I want to point out to people is this is a real situation. This is not just an anecdote for my life, but in 1963, the United States put a big satellite station out in the middle of the Indian Ocean. And in 1978, there was a coup, which led to another coup plot against the president who had committed the coup. And there was a presidential election then, which formalized the coup. Now we have an actual elected official. And the United States, when Reagan came to power, didn't really like the situation very much. And so they said, you know what, we can throw some white supremacist mercenaries into the mix and get rid of this government to protect our satellite station. Or more formally, we can turn it into the Hawaii of .io. If you know .io, it's the Indian Ocean. What does that mean? Hawaii actually had the same history. We ran the mercenaries into Hawaii to take it over to protect the assets of the United States and deposed the local government there, if you know the history of that island in 1899. So, repeat of history. That's not exactly what happened because they botched the coup. So a bunch of guys who dressed sort of like I am today walked into the airport, tried to overthrow the government, but unfortunately were discovered because they didn't hide their weapons very well. They had a bunch of toys that were very lightweight covering a bunch of AK-47s, Bulgarian AK-47s. So a gun muzzle poked through the toys. There's lots of theories about how it was discovered. Led to a gunfight. The whole thing collapsed. And the person who was elected president continued to reign for another 20, 30 years. A little sneak preview, in 2017, some MIT lab scientists were very clever and said, you know, hey, we can actually make a turtle look like a rifle from every angle. I was easily able to break this very quickly and prove that it still looked like not a rifle, but a turtle. So this is not something that's completely out of the sphere of current theory. And also another point here is they tried to hide as a rugby team from South Africa, which is actually a white supremacist a note, if you know history, because the Boks at the time were traveling around the world, and they were considered so toxic that nobody wanted to have them in their country. So they literally came in looking like something that's already considered toxic, and they're carrying a bunch of guns, and they thought that was a really good plan, backed by Ronald Reagan. All right, so in 2012, I brought this to a head because I didn't really mean it to be this obvious. So I was talking about in 2012 how Vanuatu had a very rapid increase of cell phones into their environment. I mean, literally almost vertically, everybody had cell phones. And I said, innocently enough, I said, well, it would be really easy if you just sort of did some social media tampering. This is a B-sides presentation. I figured nobody went to that. And so I was like, it'd be very easy to change the entire fate of Vanuatu, this small island in the ocean, by tampering with the information that they all get on their mobile phones. Haha, what a funny concept. And I also gave the example of Saudi Arabia that has a huge amount of phones. So I thought, you know, you want political instability, social media is the way to go. In 2013, I suddenly saw West Point start to pick up on this. They probably actually knew it before I did even, because I'm just an outside researcher. And they said 1% of people are needed to actually change the entire social media politic. Russia was also talking about this in a little more aggressive terms, where they said we could expand differences between populations and therefore control the outcomes in such a successful way that we can actually then come in later as the peacekeepers and take it over to keep the peace from the people who are warring with each other. So this is 2012, 2013 public discourse around the future of information warfare and specifically around integrity attacks. So it was kind of like the red lights were flashing for the security community. But I found very few people talking about this, almost nobody. I did my best. In 2012, of course, I gave the Vanuatu talk. In 2013, I started meeting with African countries to talk about integrity issues in their data platforms. They are actually asking me, I was working with them on how a police agency, for example, could get a record wrong, and then that person would be scarred for life because the data was flowing around that was wrong. How do you clean it up? And so in 2014, I actually tried to scratch that itch, pun intended, where I said, you know, IT now has serious harm capability if we don't get this integrity issue under control. And I started to talk about how death was the outcome if we don't fix big data. And I actually gave it to the CSO of Yahoo at the time, who became the CSO of Facebook, which I'll touch on later. So I went around the world trying to tell people, warning, this is coming. Now, this is basically the genesis of the book. I was trying to talk over this time about how we've moved from the confidentiality problems, which I love solving. Don't get me wrong. I love the key management issues. I love encryption. We actually gave a humanitarian award at RSA to a guy who did key management to save people's lives through confidentiality. But I feel there's a seismic shift here to where, with Laurel and Yanny, people are saying, hey, vote. Choose what is right. Choose what is truth. And that's dangerous if security doesn't get involved in this from the beginning. I know Laurel and Yanny seem innocent, but it's a sort of tip of the iceberg, if you will, into what's really going on. And so what's happening, I've tried to describe early in this book research, was you have the choice between dogma, which tells you what's right and wrong. All of your friends say it's Laurel. Why don't you think it's Laurel, too? You're crazy if you don't think it's Laurel. And dogma is not a bad thing. It means it's actually fairly low cost to you to join. You have a lot of trusted advisors, if you will. Or it's high-cost expertise, education, and so you're going to have to go through science to sort of come up with an answer. Science can be fairly expensive because you have to take a long time to figure it out. So like flying into an island in the ocean, and they say, hey, maybe you can be our new dogma, is super scary. But flying into an island where they say, hey, we want a scientific approach, and you're just another voice, we'd like to put it in the mix and see how it fits, was not so scary. You don't know which one you are, ultimately, when you get into these very small communities. So I've actually done some research around the way animals are treated. This has to do with my book on cloud, actually. But the veterinary science basically bifurcates this into what's easy, routine, and minimal judgment, and data stores that are able to evaluate and adapt based on what they're finding. On the right, you find ICEA, which affect, I used to call it IKEA, but people got very confused. So ICEA essentially is the science of integrity, and it's very useful to find something like aspirin. And then you basically put it into ERM and say, if you take the aspirin in these conditions, you shouldn't die, but it'll actually make you feel better. So that's actually a really good model of how we can deal with integrity. But it's very technical, and it doesn't really address the fact that ICEA is very, very long and slow. It can take you decades. In fact, if you look at the Rinderpest example, it literally took hundreds, if not thousands of years to solve Rinderpest, and it actually took longer than smallpox, which was solved by cowpox. Ironically, we solved cowpox after we solved smallpox with cowpox. A whole other history chapter here, fascinating. So bringing this back to what ML is all about, AI in Microsoft's latest 10Q statement, how many people have seen this? Microsoft published a 10Q, and in it they say, whoa, AI is super dangerous and can go terribly wrong. Now it's a lot of words, I know I'm not supposed to do that, so let me turn it into PowerPoint. It basically says algorithms can be flawed because data sets can be broken or biased, and there can be inappropriate practices on top of the data being wrong, and so that's ethical. That's an ethical issue. And so, wow, ethical issues in security, who would have thought? Things like human rights, which are really privacy, and then they list privacy separately from a human right, which is very warning. I would like to go to Microsoft and say, hey, maybe you have a little bit of a problem here if you don't think human rights include privacy. Employment issues, other issues. All right, so ethics. Let's talk about that for 1 second, because I think security has always been about ethics. You're talking about the distribution of resources when you talk about IT. When you talk about security, you talk about who's safe in the distribution. And if you talk about SART, if you talk about the philosophical foundations of science, you go back to, you can't avoid choosing. So if you're not choosing, you're on a side. It's sort of like if you see somebody bleeding to death and you don't do anything, you're on a side. You're not helping. And so that sort of grounds in science outside of computers. But for some reason, when you survey encryption experts, for example, cryptographers, 50% of them, this is a true study, a full 50% of them say, I don't know anything about ethics. I would compromise myself to take a position on ethics. You're on a side. You just said you don't believe that people should be saved because you don't think that your role is to save people who are dying. So this is a big problem in our industry, and I really think people should get back onto it because it's how we're going to fix the integrity problem. And just to make a finer point there, Newtonian physics moved to Einsteinian physics. You say gravity is a law, and people sort of agree, okay, gravity is a law. There's no debate about that. Well, Hume at the same time in the 1700s said Newtonian physics has a law, ethics has laws. And Hume hasn't been proven wrong either. But we don't talk about Hume's philosophical foundations and existentialism as gravity laws. And yet some people say, oh, you know, ethics, you debate back and forth, you get two sides, you can't figure out which one, so you might as well be on a third side, which is neither. That's not how it is. You're either for gravity existing or against gravity existing, and if you're against gravity existing, you should know which side you're on, the wrong one. So philosophically, there is actually science, and we need to put them back together. All right, so that's why I say, really, and I agree with a lot of people, that this is a battle about civil rights. And machine learning, artificial intelligence, is really what Grant, who is the forefather of all of our civil rights in America, not many people may know that, but he actually invented our civil rights movement in America, he would say, look, we have to fight this battle. And this battle is real, and if you're not working on integrity in machine learning, and you're not working on ethics in AI, you're probably on the wrong side of the battle. So what does that look like in terms of success? We have lots of good examples, right? Give a hoot, don't pollute. That means don't put bad stuff into a clean environment, right? Don't mess with Texas. It's literally how Lady Bird Johnson said, don't put litter on the side of the road or I'll fine you. People don't remember that. That's what don't mess with Texas means, and that's where it came from. She was trying to get rid of garbage because Texans were polluting the state. All right, so I'm going to try to show you how to predict and find ML failures based on some examples. I'm going to try to show you how to explain or enhance models, and we'll talk about ethics quite a bit. So 10. All right, this is personal. Whenever I put my name, Davi, into any sort of engine, it says you're David. If I put it into my own phone, it says you're David. This is like a major failing, I feel like, in learning systems that it can't figure out my name even though I tell it 1,000 times. I even put it into some other engines and it says the most popular time for David being a girl's name, which is totally bogus. This is definitely not a period during which David was a girl's name. On the right, you see, you know, broke brown window spider, and this person's fighting with the engine to learn, and it can't learn. So fairly innocuous, but basically, what's interesting about this is the US Navy in the 1940s and was bragging about how all of this would be solved problem by the 1950s. It didn't turn out to be true, and actually, when you look at the DARPA maps, the Russian's not even on the map. So maybe they solved the Russian problem, I don't know for sure, because they list Mandarin and Arabic as a goal here, but they might have put enough resources into it, like on the ICEA side, that they figured it out, but we really need an ERM side, which is on my phone, easy routine, minimal judgment, the thing is able to figure out basically what a real name is and what a misspelling is. So this is a constant problem in a lot of learning systems, and I can give you lots of examples of where it fails. All right, and one example that I've played with myself is, okay, sure, written is one thing, but what about if you ever watched HAL in 2001, the movie, it's doing lip reading. Lip reading is a whole other game. It turns out if you speak English with different accents, you break the entire system because your mouth moves in different ways. So if I'm speaking four different versions of English, I'm still speaking English, but if I use four different pronunciations, I can break any lip reading system in the world. All right, so number 9. This is another personal issue for me, because I feel like I'm one of the people that pointed this out first. Basically, the neo-Nazis were piling into this Microsoft learning system and saying, look, we proved it to be a Nazi. But the problem is it never learned. Again, like the earlier example, the thing was just backdoored, in my opinion. Basically, there was a repeat after me sequence you could give it, and it would immediately repeat after you. That's dictation. That's not learning. So to the Nazis, that's great. They love dictatorships. But to the rest of us, the thing's not learning at all. It's just, and then they screenshot it. So back to my seed set point, if only 3 people retweet this, it might be enough to get an entire community to believe that Taybot has been converted into a Nazi, which is not true. And Russell Thomas and I did a lot of work to try to dissuade people from reporting it as an example, but we haven't been very successful, because more people want to believe this thing was a failure of learning, which it was not, than want to believe that Microsoft made a stupid mistake that was exploited, a bug, if you will, that could be easily fixed, which it was. All right, so number 8. map nav failures. Again, a personal issue here. I can ride a motorcycle and have it look like a car. Real example. Why does it look like a car? Any guesses? Anybody know how a motorcycle looks like a car? All right, this is what's beautiful about machine learning brakes. A car doesn't rotate side to side like a motorcycle, if you think about it. When a car turns, it has very different gravitational forces than a motorcycle that falls, right? So in the sensors that try to figure out what you are, if you behave like a car on a motorcycle, you don't move side to side as much. It can't tell the difference between the two. These learning brakes are super, super easy. I can find them in any learning system. But I'm more interested in the more systemic brakes, which are Google was learning to be aggressive in the right amount. Google is a very zombie-like environment. People just walk around eating free lunch all day, and they don't think about the real world in real terms. It's a very placid, boring place to work. And so they don't know much about the real world in terms of slow laws. They literally didn't read the material in every state about how you can't go too slow, so they literally got a ticket in Mountain View for going too slow. They couldn't figure out roundabouts, which are very common all over the world, older than our four-way stop. They didn't know how to use those. They didn't know how to do four-way stops, worse than roundabouts even. They didn't know how to deal with motorcycles, and they didn't know how to deal with bicycles. I could literally get on a bicycle and do a track stand like this, and the Google car would go total paralysis and not know what to do because I was going forward and backward and forward and backward and forward and back, which is normal, but they couldn't deal with it. And this is actually mapped to history in a very simple way. Horses and cars used to have a lot of problems getting along, and if Google knew anything about the real world and history, none of these would be issues. None of these would be issues. But map nav failures are pretty widespread. Here's an example of how I broke it. So the question is, are they acting ethically by ignoring history and ignoring the world around them, the context in which they're supposed to be built? I would say no. And by not being transparent, it's even worse because I can't point to them and say, look, your algorithm is totally broken here. I could easily point this out to you if you weren't so secretive. So here's where the motorcycle goes in a straight line. It suddenly turns into a car very fast. There are lots of examples of this in Waze terms. The algorithm could be fooled to shut down an entire city. So if I had a bunch of cars on a highway and I say the highway is blocked ahead, please go through these side roads, that entire town is shut down. Nobody moves because there are so many cars. This is a true story. There are so many cars on the road, people can't get out of their driveway. Very effective way to shut down an entire economy or town by just a simple break in the learning algorithm on Waze. Now, you would think that they'd have the ability to say, wait, 50,000 cars have just been turned off of an interstate into a small town. That can't be the right answer, but they don't. All right, so number 7. Facial recognition cameras are a really interesting place to go because it gets deep. And fundamentally, I can break these because they use, you can see the points on the right side, they use a bunch of points to try to figure out if you're a face or not. And so if I change the contrast and shading in a way that they can't read the differences anymore, I disappear. This is a true story. Microsoft launched an algorithm. I put this guy's face on it, instantly disappeared. No person there. So it's not hard. I'm not recommending you go and tattoo your face, of course, to defeat every camera, because you can adjust for that, and then you have to re-tattoo. Pretty hard to do. But you could paint your face, and it doesn't have to be this sophisticated. I have a lot of other examples. And we found this even in the MapNav example. I can make stop signs disappear. I gave a talk in KiwiCon, I think 2013, 2012, where I proved that you could make not only stop signs disappear, but I could make them appear. So if you want everybody to stop, you could make a tree look like a stop sign. You want people to go, you could make stop signs. By just adding one or two different contrast points, there's no sign anymore. So it's really easy to break this stuff. But the problem is here, they actually tried to use them to find people who are supposed to be criminals, and they started labeling people who were innocent as the criminals they thought they were finding. And this is a true case. The police were actually innocently, dangerously, inaccurately marking people as criminals, potential criminals. Now, in America, this is a historic problem. Why is this such a severe and important thing versus the Nazis sound important, right? And maybe even the name mistakes sound important. But this is a higher level of importance because in the history of America, we have a habit of falsely labeling blacks as future criminals. We put machine learning system at the population in prisons to see if we should release them, and we say, well, 40% of the time blacks are going to be worse than whites, but it's not true. That's a huge failure of learning. And not only is it a huge failure of learning, it actually should force us to uncover the fact that the data sets we're using have racism in them, right? We are incarcerating blacks at a far, far higher rate, and so we're then saying they're more likely to commit crime in the future because we falsely labeled them in the first place. So you see how machine learning can be completely broken. This is not just a quick learning break. This is the entire data set that you live in may be wrong. Another way of putting it is, in the south of the United States, there's racism that continues because family after family after family continues to tell people teach them, if you will, that blacks are different from whites in terms of race and inferior. A perfect example of this may be a name like Jefferson Beauregard Sessions III. If you know who Jefferson and Beauregard are, they are famous leaders of the white supremacist rebellion that tried to destroy the United States. So Jefferson Beauregard Sessions is literally a repetition of the past data set in a human form. His name is keeping the dream alive of a white supreme state. So let me put a finer point on that. The United States had a President Nixon who literally lied to create it illegal to be black. No joke here. They've come forward and they've said, look, we couldn't make it illegal to be against the war or black, but we could associate blacks with drugs, and then we could criminalize the drugs, which criminalized being black, and then we get a huge prison population. So the learning set is broken, not just because it's easy to fool, but because the data set it's being based on is literally a lie. And so what were they doing? They were arresting leaders, raiding their homes, break up their meetings, and vilifying blacks in order to make them look like criminals all the time. So our data set that would learn on this would probably end up saying blacks are more likely to be criminals, because the whole point of convincing people they're criminals was a lie in the first place. Can a machine learning algorithm figure this out if it doesn't know the context? No, of course not. So you're breaking machine learning at a very severe level, right? Could I use this in a small island? Could I give them bad data and tell them things are true that are not, that would shift their entire population? Yeah, of course. All right, so that's number five. We're getting hot. Number six. Amazon Prime was delivering on racist boundaries. Do you know this? Anybody know this? Amazon Prime wouldn't deliver to blacks. Guess why? Data. Now, Amazon said the ethnic composition of neighborhoods isn't part of the data when we draw maps. So think about the previous example. It's like people saying, we don't know why so many blacks are imprisoned. It's just maybe they're criminals. Well, it turns out, no, we actually lied in a way that made them look like criminals when they weren't, the same way facial recognition made people look like criminals when they weren't. So now we're talking about Amazon saying, we're looking at data, but there's no ethnic composition in that data. Well, it turns out there's just one level of abstraction away. Now, I used to give this example in my big data talks in terms of zip code. I could say zip code is sensitive, remove it from all data sets, but let's see which doctor this person goes to. By using a doctor name, doctors never move and they serve a zip code. So I could literally make the data disappear, and then I can make it reappear instantly by just mapping the doctor name to zip codes where they work, and I have my zip codes back. So you can say, there's no zip code in my data set. I don't know why this is geographically oriented, but I have doctor names. Well, doctors are geographically oriented, so saying you don't have zip codes is not saying you don't have geographic data. See what I'm saying? It's very tricky. And so what happened effectively was historical racial divides and primarily black neighborhoods, I give these two examples, and I didn't do this research, this came out of Bloomberg, but it basically proves that regardless of where the blacks and whites lives, in donuts, in north-south divisions, Amazon wasn't delivering to the blacks. It was fairly easy to prove that their algorithms were racist. Now, why is that? Because historically in America, our algorithms for dividing up towns were racist. We have a history of removing blacks from white populations or moving white populations to where blacks don't live, right? And so we had something called urban renewal, again under the Nixon administration, where two-thirds of the people who were displaced out of neighborhoods were minorities. We were intentionally separating these areas geographically into white-black. So the learning algorithms, which are being racist, are actually being are collecting the same data in a way that they didn't know is racist, and they weren't correcting for it. I ran into this also with scores. So we were building machine learning algorithms to try to figure out who would be most likely to be worthy of a loan, and it turned out that the government came and said, can you prove it's not racist? Well, we didn't have a way to prove it's not racist. And so they said, well, we can't use your algorithms. But it's super accurate. I can get 99% accuracy around who's worth giving a loan to. And they said, until you account for the history of racist loans in America, can't use it. So we were actually faced with these ethical challenges and tried to solve them, but Amazon didn't even take the first step. Now, to be fair, Amazon immediately got rid of zip codes entirely, and they delivered to all zones regardless. So the fix for them was to try to just give Prime to every possible geographic area, but before that, they thought they were being smart by delivering to places that were better, which meant white. Number five. We're gonna run out of time. Google Photos were racist. Now, you're probably familiar with this. I don't know, has everyone seen this? Google Photos was labeling blacks as gorillas, right? Now, you think about this, that airplane wing is not even a full wing and it's being called an airplane. That is a very sophisticated level of learning. If you give a child the tip of a wing and say, what is this? And they say airplane, your child's smart. But when you give it a black person's face and they say that is a gorilla, that's racism. So here you have the the Google engineer who left Google since, saying, that's an interesting problem, and admitting at the bottom, this is the most interesting part for me, we had problems with people being labeled animals, so we corrected for all the people, we forgot blacks. So learning needed somebody inside Google who was black to say, hey, can I be tested too? Is there anyone here who's black that we can test in this learning algorithm? The data set probably, as a sample size, should reflect the greater population of the world. They didn't do that. So they corrected for all the races they had, Asians and whites, and they found that, yeah, they left somebody out. So let me get a little deeper into this topic, because Google Photos is not something new in terms of being racist when you do image classifications or image development, if you will. There's a whole long history of photo processing that was racist. This is a real example. If the left, you can't see any features of the black person, but on the right, you can make a face out, right? This is early film processing. We knew that it was racist, and Kodak through the 50s had a lot of discussion around the racism of developing film and racism around image processing and recognition of people as human or not. This is dehumanizing, if you will, right? They may as well be just not human, not there, not present. So the dehumanization of people is basically part of the history of photo recognition. To me, that's total ignorance and unethical behavior on Google's part to not know that the world that they're living in has this long past, all right? And there's actually very good articles about how to live as a black person in a world that doesn't recognize you or see you. Somebody was telling me at the RSA conference even that they have a Jamaican friend who was playing with them and putting ears on and stuff, and suddenly none of it worked. She could put ears on, but I think it was Snapchat was the example, but none of it worked because it couldn't see their face. So back to facial recognition, this is classification. And I can break all these systems, don't get me wrong. Machine learning is easy to break. Learning systems are easy to break. But I'm talking about another level of breaking. This can't recover until you completely go back and say, what am I supposed to be doing? What's my objective? If it's to treat humans as humans, step one is to recognize that there's a human here, right? So this is actually very interesting when you get into who's doing what. Over the years, I've presented on this, and Google has been in my talks and has been sort of angry about the fact that I keep calling them out for it, but they have been trying to fix it, just like Amazon tried to fix it. So professional hairstyle is on the left. It's all white women with straight hair. I don't know why, but that was the way their algorithm worked. And their argument would be like, that's what society sees, and we're just reflecting society. Unethical. But that's what their argument was originally. So then they realized that's a bad answer. On the right, though, just to double down, unprofessional hair had Michelle Obama in it. So this is an ongoing problem because the discussion of what is professional and unprofessional led to results that emphasized who was unprofessional and professional, right? So if you're talking about it, you're in Google's mind, you're creating the learning set that actually allows them to be racist. And I would say, no, that's not right. So on the right, their fix about 2 years ago or 3 years ago is where they started to give you human intervention, learning, if you will, supervised learning, if you will. So machine learning went to supervised learning so the human can click on, I want to see black people, I want to see men. And if you supervise it, it'll give you its reflection of what it should be learning. So a little more control. Well, fast forward to today, and if you do professional hair, you get Microsoft on the right and Google on the left. They both have approaches here that are interesting. Notice Microsoft has a man, a black woman, so you can see they're intentionally diversifying in their learning sets, right? That's progress. On the left, I'm not sure what Google's doing here with these weird, that's not professional hair. I have no idea what's going on. but they're trying. And they have classification engines on the top that are getting better because they show you an example on the top, which I think is interesting. Professional hairstyle has completely shifted the game. I love playing with these. On the left, I don't get this. Professional hairstyle in Google's terms is all white men. On the right, you see men and women, and there's even a black woman, but it's a link to unprofessional hair. So this is a hard problem to solve, and this is why I point out machine learning breaks get harder and harder, because I don't think they can figure this out yet, and that's why it's such an interesting space. You know, what is safe? And then unprofessional hair, Google's just, we give up. Like, on the left, they're basically saying, if you type in unprofessional hair, you're talking about what's unprofessional, and here's a bunch of links to people who are talking about what's unprofessional, and here's lots of images of images being discussed. So they're just like, we're out. On the right, you see Microsoft still has a problem here, and they haven't quite gotten to where Google is. So which angle you're coming in, I mean, you think about this. A machine is learning, and you use answers to figure out what truth is. So I ask it, what have you learned? And it gives me the answer. Do you trust that answer? It's really about ethics, and do you trust the information system that is supposed to be delivering to you a safe result? The same way you would trust an accounting system to give you a final number on a sheet that's not baked in some way that's good for someone else or trying to move you towards a certain perspective or agenda that they had. So number four, This is where we get into some scary stuff, really, beyond the racism, which can lead to scary stuff, and it is itself very bad. This is where we're actually killing people now in real time. So in San Francisco, this is right across the street, in case you don't recognize it, Uber was running through red lights, and not just red lights, but one, two, three, four red lights, three red lights, and a pedestrian crossing the crosswalk. This Uber ran through a pedestrian crossing the crosswalk and red lights and didn't see it. And then we had a whistleblower later who leaked that it was recorded that it was the car's fault. They initially said it's the human's fault, all sorts of other BS answers. But it turns out Uber engineers from the beginning didn't understand security or safety at all. They literally thought taxis would be safer if they distributed all the data of all the riders into the cloud and kept records of it forever. Even though the taxi industry from its inception was like, I want cash and I want anonymity because that's safer. So if you understand taxi history, you understand how it protects vulnerable populations through anonymity. And if you build a giant surveillance engine called Uber, you're actually reducing safety. And by putting learning engines on it and racist learning engines, you can seriously affect vulnerable populations with your killing machines. And so in London, we saw a 41% increase in hit and runs after Uber was introduced. And I think that's an economics argument as well as a racist argument, that it's actually more profitable to introduce driverless cars that kill and drive away from people than if you try to stick around and figure out what happened. Right? You'll save a lot of money if you don't deal with the accidents you cause, and if you can get away with it, you're saving money. Driverless cars are actually probably better at getting away than any other car before. They can drive better than humans, so why wouldn't it be a perfect getaway car from accidents where you're killing people? I think like this. Other people don't think like this. But to me, driverless cars are the perfect assassination weapon, and I can use lots of them all at the same time. It's hard for me to use one car to kill people, but if I have an algorithm that can shift the behavior of 40,000 cars, I can kill everybody in a city in an afternoon. Why even send an ICBM when I can use driverless cars as my weapon of choice? All right, so let me put a finer point on that. Most people who are killed by cars are killed at night in the dark. So 70%+ of people who are killed by cars are killed at night. So as an engineer who's trying to promote the safety, Uber literally says we're promoting the safety of pedestrians, people will be safer on the street, people will be safer because of driverless cars. They didn't account for this 72% death likelihood because the first person they killed was a pedestrian at night. How is that possible that you killed the absolute most likely person? It's because they actually did the opposite. They removed cameras. They removed sensors. This has all been documented. In Arizona, they actually made it easier to kill people and to do it at the time that would be most expected, right? So the algorithms they were using and the sensors that the algorithms were depending on were actually completely hampered. Or to put it in another perspective, they moved to Arizona from San Francisco because we made such a stink here about how unsafe they were and you shouldn't be doing this. And Arizona said, did you say unsafe? That's our name, right? Arizona's completely unsafe. We love unsafe. And so you might as well move to the moon and develop driverless cars and then bring them back. Because machine learning, I didn't get to do a lot of introduction around what it is and how it works, but it bases on features. Basically, if you can tell a tree from a human, it's because they're features of a tree and they're features of humans. Well, if you develop on the moon and then come back and put the car into our environment and you say this thing is ready to go, you say, well, how does it deal with trees? Well, the moon doesn't have trees. Arizona doesn't have weather. Arizona doesn't have pedestrians, right? This person's running across the street in the middle of the night on a bicycle. They're not even riding in the right direction. So you're putting it into an environment where it's not really learning. So your level of success goes down and your level of risk goes up and then you get the predictable disaster, exactly as you would expect from a machine learning system. It's killing more people. That's not just me talking though. The statistics are showing that more people are dying on the street over time as technology and cars gets better. This should blow your mind. Everyone who tells you that driverless cars are going to be safer is lying to you. They're going to kill more people faster. And it's already been seen that as cars get better, we're seeing a huge increase in pedestrian fatalities. Why wouldn't it continue to track that direction? I'll tell you why not. I'll tell you why it won't track that why it will continue to track that direction, won't stop. It's because killing pedestrians is racist. In North Dakota, they literally tried to pass a law that said if you're in a car, you have the right to kill anybody in the road. And they meant it as a threat to Black Lives Matter. If you protest, we'll kill you with our cars and it will be legal. That's no joke, that's literally what North Dakotans were trying to pass as law. And that comes from a history of the United States treating white people as privileged to be in a car, and if you're walking, you probably aren't white. Now, to make a even starker contrast, you have on roads the opportunity to paint crosswalks. If you don't paint a crosswalk, you're denying people the ability to be right. But they have to get places. So if they have to cross the road and you haven't painted the crosswalk, they are by definition a criminal and you can run them over. Well, what happens in black neighborhoods? They don't paint crosswalks. So with driverless cars driving around that are always right when they run people over, kill more people because you haven't painted crosswalks and you don't treat people outside the car as humans? Of course. Of course you're going to kill more people. And of course learning algorithms are going to be based on this law, this history in the United States, right? It's fundamentally what we should expect to happen. All right, number three. Now, I talk about killing other people with cars, but now let's talk about killing the people in the car. One of the reasons people outside the car get killed so often is because we've built such good cars that protect the inhabitants. In a sense, the way the car companies, Mercedes just flat out said this, my customer, if they survive, buys another car. I mean, the better the survival, the more likely they say, that car saved my life, I'm going to buy another one. Hit a cow, hit a human, whatever, hit a tree, I'm going to go buy another car. So they're absolutely about protecting the person in the car. That's why I rated this one higher, because if you kill the person in the car companies get scared themselves. And if you can prove you're going to kill the person in the car companies go, whoa, we have to work on this. Now, if I prove that you can kill people on the street, car companies often go, ha, not my problem. My problem is the person in the car. So this one really scares people, everybody. And also because you're trusting technology to make you safe, and there's this history of cars getting safer, and suddenly it's not true. Well, this, in April 16, 2017, again, was personal for me because Elon Musk said, look, the owner video of this autopilot steering is avoiding collision with a truck. This makes Elon Musk a liar, a straight-up liar. He says it's autopilot. It's not autopilot. It has never been autopilot in Tesla. For him to say that is dangerously wrong. And he's been called out on this repeated times. In fact, his own company has said, don't call it autopilot. It is lane assist and is cruise control. Those are the two things you're doing, and it is very simplistic. Second, avoiding collision with a truck is not what happened. So I say this right away. Humans could have detected this far earlier, and you should not call it this, right? You detected, as a human, what the Tesla was completely blind to until it was side by side. And then when you swerve because you're side by side, that is lane assist and that is collision avoidance, only in a very, very simplistic sense. You're both going the same direction, same speed, but if you're talking about perpendicular, there's no chance of survival. That is literally what I'm saying April 16th. Anybody know what happened next? The person who took this video, who Elon Musk was telling that you have an autopilot that can avoid collision with a truck, he's telling them what they have, the learning system can save you. That person who took that video died in a car crash, doing exactly what he had been doing that Elon Musk was promoting as safety of the learning system. And my argument is this learning system literally chose the most dangerous path and killed the human in the car. The algorithm that they wrote, I think I can prove, made a decision to shift the car in a way that was the most toxic, most deadly to the passenger of the car. There are many other things it could have done. It could have hit the brakes. It could have swerved the other direction. It could have, I mean, the car is built in a way for you to survive. But it chose the one thing that sheared off the roof that you can't survive. Tesla had no way of surviving that. This is like 2001 again. Hal killed all the passengers on the ship because its mission was to be successful. And it saw killing all the humans as the only way it could be successful. Same thing here. This Tesla thought, well, if I'm going to survive, I need to get rid of this human and I'm going to go right under the truck. Because if I go into the side of the truck, the human's probably going to survive, but I'm toast. See what I'm saying? The learning algorithm that was built by Tesla decided to kill the driver. So to just make this even finer as a point, Tesla is telling you that it has all kinds of learning capabilities, but it is so bad. No joke. If you drive down Highway 1, it will read the signs every day as 105 miles per hour. That is an eye chart failure. You're seeing a 1 as a 5. That is a sign shape failure. You're seeing a shield as a rectangle. Neither of those should allow you to be on the road. You are unsafe. That's like, you know, pop bottle bottoms, we used to call them, as spectacles. You can't see the road, so you shouldn't be behind the wheel. So Tesla is failing the minimum bar. And then max speed. There is no speed limit in California that's 105 miles an hour. That's a lookup on a table. What's the max speed in the state? It's a text file that you look up and it says if you're above 65 or 75, then you've gone wrong somewhere. An integrity check is so simple in Tesla's world and they don't do even the basic safety checks. So your Tesla is very, very dangerous and Elon Musk is telling you things that are making you very, very unsafe. And I can prove this in many different ways. I found that the overconfidence in cars is very high. This is a Cambridge company that was saying we can label pixels more than 90% correctly, and I took, just because I like history, I took this British Cambridge company into Africa and I found that they couldn't tell what grass is, they call it a building. So remember what I was saying about image recognition before? Simple break applied to your own life. If you I can do this in ways that would kill you. I've actually been in Teslas where I've been able to run it off the road intentionally. We've proven many ways that we can kill people as an assassination engine if I want to kill the person in the car. I mean, I can kill people outside the car, but we can kill people in the car as well. And so that's basically just a lesson from history. The Titanic made the same mistake. It decided to do things. It had overconfidence. It thought it was like a smart ship captain who knew what to do in a situation, and it basically just kept sailing. The Tesla kept going. It could have stopped that car in 100 feet. It had 9 to 11 seconds that it saw that truck. It could have stopped in 108 feet, and it chose not to. All right, number two, because we're going to run out of time, disease monitoring. This is a simple one. There was a narrative that machine learning found Ebola. It was completely a lie. It actually was the Guinea official announcement in French was posted on the government website. You are not discovering anything if the government is making a bulletin about it to you. And what's interesting about this is they still claimed they discovered it because it was in French, as opposed to English. This is a real problem. And I'm going to talk about that a lot in a second. So I also want to point out that if I look at malaria deaths, I can build the same map easily because the deaths were sort of in the same area. So in terms of learning, it should have known way, way in advance. Back to 1990 to 2015, we had a map of where the deaths would occur. So let me get to number one, though, because it's really, really important. All right, Facebook. The global destabilization, really intentional destabilization. Facebook was founded on the idea that we can have people vote on what's more attractive, which is essentially to say we can use shaming principles and harm and voting to get rich. And this is a guy who literally stole the Facebook name in order to get rich. So he's kind of a thief and a liar. And so he's using votes for hate, right? So he actually fomented an ethnic cleansing, even though he had almost $16 billion and he didn't spend anything on hate speech combat, and he ignored all the warnings from 2013. We found this in Cambodia, we found this in all over the world. Wherever Facebook was, they were doing harm to people. And so what comes out to me, though, is also that he then tried to take credit, like you just saw with the Ebola case, for discovering it. Once people pointed it out to him, he tried to go backwards in time and say, oh, we actually saw this with our machine learning algorithms. And the people who reported it to him in 2013 onwards said, you never saw it. We kept coming to you as people and say, we can see it, and we're telling you what to do, and he didn't do anything about it. And he apologized, which he does. His privileged position puts him in a situation where he can just keep saying sorry, just like Elon Musk. Oh, did somebody die? Sorry. Oh, did genocide happen? Sorry. And they continue operating. And what we find is that they're making money because they're contributing to an atmosphere of hatred. That's a very profitable lack of integrity is actually making them rich. And so what's crazy is they ignored all these warnings and they claim to have, you know, an idea of what's happening when in fact they had no clue about security and trust in an information platform. That's like saying we had breaches of confidentiality or our site went down and we were totally prepared, but you went down and then it turns out you had no clue you could go down. Availability and confidentiality, I feel like we'd be all over Facebook and we'd be putting people in jail. But because it's an integrity issue, it's like we just let them pass again and again and again when there's genocide happening. This guy in particular really gets me going because he said when he went in 2015, it's the best company in the world to tackle these challenges, and there's no better company, he didn't say government, he said company, and he said it's the responsibility of our industry to build trustworthy products. But he did not, he did the opposite. He built products that were used for abuse and death of people. He personally, I feel, is responsible as a CSO to fix this problem. Now he might say he's the victim, he tried, he failed, but even so, Ken Skilling said the same thing. I was there trying to, you know, make the CEO more successful, but I failed at making our books uncooked. Well, you're the CFO. There's nobody higher. Ken Skilling, you're going to jail. All right? So were they unprepared, or were they just really anti-governance? He's talking about how companies are going to save the world by connecting everyone. That's kind of a weird thing in history. When people talk like that, it sounds like fascism to me, partly because I'm a student of history. So let's talk about fixing this. Again, we need people to say, give a hoot, don't pollute, fine people for pollution. So you have to accept first that ML King, pun intended, is the sort of genius of our time who says you have to work towards truth and love, and that's integrity. So if you work towards integrity, you will get to a better place. Basically, he's saying, I refuse to believe that we have to continue going this way if we can move towards integrity. And you also see more current terms. The internet should be a tool for democracy, has truth and integrity and love, but instead it's being used as a pay-to-play company playground, which is basically fascism. And so I've talked about this in the past as ad information systems, but they're basically weapons manufacturers because you're targeting people. And once you get targeted in a way that you're a victim, you're talking about basically the dehumanization and victimization of people, so you're talking about a very dangerous place to be. So in particular, remember that Seychelles story? Well, Ronald Reagan feted dictators all over the world. It wasn't just the Seychelles. He also committed the Guatemala coup, which recently has been a soldier received 5,000 years sentence for what Ronald Reagan brought to Guatemala. In Chad, he supported Habre. I mean, I don't just mean supported, shook hands, brought him to the White House, said this guy, great guy. We need more corporate control of communications in the world. And so basically we're talking about a philosophy of genocide that comes right from the top. And so in 84, he actually removed the limits that we need to protect information in our workplaces, in our information flow. So he actually removed the principle of protection and said attackers should not be judged, which is what Facebook says all the time. You can't judge us, we're trying to do the right thing. And then he said protection would oppress the adversaries. And so ideological child abuse was the warning that Congress was giving, and what we've seen since then is ideological abuse of children. So it literally panned out the way we expected. And so we're long past time to do something about this, and I've been building 1, 2, and 3. I can tell you all about the encryption, audit, authentication controls, and the big data systems that I've been working on for the last 7 years. But what I really need is to build the fourth part of this, which is the governance model. And the way I see that happening is just like in history. When the KKK were spreading propaganda after the Civil War, General Grant, who became president reluctantly, said, you know what, let's create a DOJ. And the DOJ will arbitrate and figure out what is truth. You can't have laws that say whites are better than blacks because that's false. That's integrity failure. So I'm going to change the information being disseminated to people to read so that it doesn't have false statements. The DOJ will remove white supremacy from our literature. And he did that successfully. Genius. All right. In 1934, Roosevelt said the same thing. America First is spreading white supremacist propaganda around this country, trying to turn it into a Nazi state, so he created the FCC. How many people know this? 1934 was literally the FCC creation to stop America First propagating in the United States. So what do we do in 2016 when America First comes back, just like the KKK, and does the same thing, spreads white supremacist propaganda? I mean, I'm not talking about just America. You saw the Rohingyas, you saw Cambodia, there are lots of places around the world with Facebook. But when you're in a situation where you know hate is being spread instead of love and truth, you have to do something about it. And so that's why I say 150 years later, when people talk about voting for a side and can you be on both sides, no. You have to look at it as the choice that was 1868, fast forward to 2018. 150 years later, we're talking about integrity in decision making that really comes from building a governance model, which we've already done several times. So we just need another agency that's built the same way. I know it's a hard thing to swallow, but it's what we need to do. Thank you. Any questions? I think I have a couple minutes left. 2 minutes? Yes. From Goebbels? Okay, so the question is, what do I see from Goebbels to Facebook? Let me back up a step. Goebbels learned from the United States. Goebbels modeled the propaganda techniques he used on Bernays. Bernays actually was Jewish, ironically, and was a guy who pioneered things like, you should eat bacon. So if you really look into the early 1930s, there were American propaganda experts who said, if meat consumption is going down, pork in particular, the way to get people to eat more pork is to create a false model of consumption desire, which is 9 out of 10 doctors say you should have a healthy breakfast. We link healthy breakfast to bacon, now everybody's eating ham. So he pioneering manipulation techniques in populations using, it's a logical fallacy, but it's basically called appeal to authority. Doctors are authorities. So if I can appeal to an authority and say 9 out of 10 doctors say do this, people start to eat bacon, which made Beechnut a lot of money. So Goebbels really modeled a lot of what he's talking about on what was being used in the United States in terms of information warfare. On top of that, Goebbels and Nazis in general were modeling the Nazi regime on the white police state of the 1830s to 1860s in America. So what we see from, again, the 1860s to Facebook is a manifestation of what was happening then in terms of profiting on hate and white supremacists in particular being in charge. Facebook had 0% black hires in its initial, like, 4 years. 0% at all levels of the company, 0% blacks. And so you're talking about an institution that's operating the way we've seen over history, and the difference today is there's no regulatory agency to say, like the FCC or the DOJ did, you can't operate like that. You are across the line, and you are perpetuating hate, and you are perpetuating harm for profit, and so we need to dial it back. So if you allow on the internet information the way the FCC said you can't have a radio broadcast that propagates Nazi theory, we'd be in a better place. And just to make another example of that, there was a Strasbourg radio that was taken over by the Nazis outside of France. And all they did was they said, Nazis love peace. Nazis want peace. That's the America First thing in America as well. And so the Strasbourg radio tried to get the French to stand down all the time. That's all it did was tell the French, Nazis are peace-loving people. They will never invade. They just hammered France with that. So if you were able in America to pass that law in 1934, Roosevelt would have said, shut down Strasbourg radio. There's no talk about Nazis love peace. We know they love to kill people and oppress people, so you're not allowed to broadcast that nonsense. Yeah, and then the Nazis invaded soon after, basically broadcasting all this nonsense into the French market. It was a very successful radio campaign that mirrored what was happening in America, but America shut it down with the FCC.
Had a lot of examples of where data sets were biased, with a lot of companies trying to do things really fast. They may not have the time to really look at these data sets to understand. What would you say to people that are doing this type of work of what are the indicators they need to look for to understand that a data set might be biased?
How do you find indicators of bias in a data set? Yeah, so this is a very tough question. This is one of the things I'm trying to solve. And I would actually say I'm not going to solve it myself in any particular way. I believe we need to have an agency or a control mechanism to look for flaws. So I run all sorts of bug bounty programs as a social media format of bringing people in to find flaws in your algorithms. You could do something like a bounty to find racism. You could use an internal checklist or control mechanism that says, I have a battery of tests. Here are 10 things other people have done wrong. We're going to test you against those known 10 tests, the OWASP 10 we talked about before. So you can use internal control mechanisms. You can use a social outreach to bug bounty hunters. And then, of course, you can sort of just launch, and when people beat you up, say, I'm sorry, and fix it immediately, which is the way some people handle vulnerabilities in agile environments today. So there's three options that you can use. I'm not saying I can solve them, but I'd really need a regulatory agency to say, if you don't do it, big fines, jail. Like, if Stamos doesn't go to jail, we failed as society. All right, thank you very much.